morning. In my today's class, I'll be discussing a topic called management's fraud-related responsibility. This particular topic is quite important for management to understand that they also hold a very, very responsible position in the organization. No matter what, even if the lowest level of the employee is doing something wrong in the company, management is equally responsible for that. This particular liability is called imputed liability. The imputed liability means a company is liable by act of its employee. As we already understood, that there is something called principal-agent relationship. The principal is always bound by act of an agent. So whenever an employee does something wrong, the employee, the management is equally responsible for those acts. That is what we call imputed liability. It is believed or assumed that company was aware of this wrongdoing, and also two things needs to be proven in this case. One, that the employee did something wrong in the course of business and the benefit was going to corporation. It could be direct or indirect. That is what we call organizational crime. In this organizational crime, even if management was not aware of it personally, it will be assumed that company knew that because the benefit was actually flowing to the company. That's where imputed liability comes into picture, and that is where company is under more responsibility to prevent and detect fraud. So this chapter will primarily deal with how management is responsible to prevent and detect fraud. When it comes to responsibility towards fraud, it is not the responsibility of a fraud investigator or auditor to find the fraud. The first and foremost responsibility lies with management. Management may include directors, senior management, chairman, and the first line of the company. They are very, very responsible for wrongdoings in the company. So, as we discuss, auditor will come later and he will just see the compliance part. Though auditors are also having certain responsibility towards fraud, but it's not their first responsibility. Its first responsibility lies with the management to prevent and make sure the fraud will not be repeated. So the company needs to have a very strong fraud management policy in place. This chapter primarily deals with those responsibilities. There are three objectives in a company, and there is something called COSO's internal control guideline. Anybody who has studied the internal audit or the audit concept would know that there is a concept of internal control and then there is a concept of internal audit. Internal control is a control which a company has to make sure the process runs smoothly, there is no compliance related issue, and the financial or non-financial information are communicated to the stakeholder in a very, very transparent and correct manner. The task of internal audit activity is to come and make sure that internal control exists and running smoothly. So that is the difference between IC and IA. The IC is task of management and IA is the task of auditor. Now when we understand the difference between two, let's focus on IC part. The internal control basically has three objectives. Operating objective, reporting objective, and compliance objective. When we say operating objective, it says that operating activities are running smoothly and efficiently. Reporting activity says that company is transparent and fair in reporting to the stakeholder, and compliance activity says that all the compliance related things are being followed. These are three prime objective on internal control. And then comes COSO's guidelines about internal control. There is a body called Tradeway Commission which came into picture in 1985. The primary purpose of Tradeway Commission to talk about internal audit or internal controls role in terms of fraud detection and prevention. The new name of Trade Commission is the reporting of fraudulent activity. So they have changed the name slightly, but earlier it was known as a Trade Commission. So back in 1985 it came into picture, and which also mentioned these three objectives of internal control: operating, reporting and compliance related. The management needs to make sure the company has a proper fraud prevention programs. Also, they have to make sure that these are properly communicated to every employee. There is something called USSC, US Sentencing Corporate, USSC stands for US Corporate Sentencing Guideline. So this US's Corporate Sentencing Guidelines basically deal with what is corporate responsibility when it comes to fraud. Up to what extent company is responsible when fraud occurs. If company can prove in the court that they have all proper and effective fraud management programs, and then they make sure the fraud related policies are being communicated to the employee, their punishment can be reduced to the larger extent. That's where company needs to make sure that they not only need to have a fraud management program, but also it needs to be communicated to the employee. Just because company has created a piece of paper and they have put it on the front desk, that does not mean that fraud prevention policy is being adhered to. The company these days takes time to time some kind of online assessment of employee to make sure that they understand what is the fraud. What are the policies related to it? What are the do's and don'ts? And most of the time, it is mandatory for every employee to go through this assessment and score 100% it. When they give this exam and pass it, it clearly shows that they have understood the policy. So that's where a company needs to make up proper fraud prevention policies, and they have to make sure that every level of the company is aware of these policies. The company needs to have a zero tolerance on fraud, and that message needs to be very loud and clear. The moment employee would come to know that company is lenient about fraud related thing, there will be more occurrence of fraud. How, up to what extent we need to have a fraud management program entirely depends on three factors. The size of the company. The bigger the size, the different or the bigger kind of fraud prevention programs are required. The industry the company operates in, that also makes a lot of difference. There are certain industries which are more prone to fraud, such as banking and financial institutes. Every industry comes up with their own set of policies and the problems also. So the related fraud can also vary, and company needs to create their fraud prevention program as per the need. Also, the complexity in the company makes too much of difference. The more complex corporate structure have a higher tendency of fraud. And last but not the least, occurrence of similar conduct before. If the frequency of fraudulent activities are high, company needs to have very, very strong prevention policies. That shows that company has a tendency to have frauds again and again. In order to stop it once and for all, company needs to be very strong about fraud prevention policy. The mention is that what is management's responsibility when it comes to fraud and how to take care of it. So if you have to summarize this, it's just that management is the first, having first responsibility towards fraud, which may include the senior management. We need to understand that ethics never flow from bottom to up. It always flow from top to down. In order to have a stronger, healthier, ethical environment in the business, company needs to be very ethical at top. The ethical tone needs to be set at the top level, and then it flows down the hierarchy. Company needs to make proper zero tolerance policy, and they have to be very clear with this and communicate it to the employee in the language or manner they understand. So this is about management's fraud-related responsibility. Now it's time for us to understand one more responsibility when it comes to auditor's responsibility related to fraud. We have discussed what is management's responsibility when it comes to fraud in the company, Now it's time for us to understand the auditor's responsibility related to fraud. As we understand by now that it is not primary responsibility of an auditor to detect fraud. The task of auditor is to check the compliance part. If he is an internal auditor, his task is to check whether the internal control exists or not, whether the internal control runs smoothly and efficiently or not. But when it comes to external audit, the external auditor's task is to check the compliance part, whether the company is doing transparent financial reporting, whether they are complying with all the laws and regulations or not. So as we understood the guidelines and the work profile of both internal and external auditor, it is not the primary responsibility of them to detect fraud. But at the same time, when they come across any situation which indicates potential fraud risk factor, the auditor cannot be blind towards it. Just because he is not under having responsibility to find fraud primarily. International Auditing Standard ISA 240 talks about it. So ISA 240 says that what is auditor's responsibility related to the material risk factors. Materiality is something which says how relevant that particular thing is. Materiality may depend on the monetary value or some other factor which impacts the decision of user. So this is how we define what is material. ISA 240 talks about that responsibility of auditor which deals with material risk assessments. Then come ISA 315. ISA 315 further elaborates it and says what is material risk. Now before getting into that material risk part, let's understand why people commit crime. There are three reasons why people commit crime. One, there has to be perceived financial pressure, there has to be an opportunity, and then there has to be the rationalization for the act. These three factors are called fraud risk factor. So as an auditor, as we understand that it's not something we are going with the mindset that company has a fraud, but at the same time, while doing your audit, if you come across any single factor which indicates toward potential fraud, try to gather more evidences around it. Try to understand what could be the potential risk factor here and how much is the risk which is material in this case. If company sees any kind of potential risk factor such as incentive to commit crime, or financial pressure on the company, then auditor needs to be little more cautious while doing audit. Let me share an example. Suppose you are doing audit of a company X. Company X has applied for loan with a bank, and then bank is asking for some good ratios, the change in the sale. So the bank basically is putting a condition towards your client that unless and until sales reaches to this level or your ratios reaches to this level, we will not sanction some other loan or we will not extend the current limit. In this case, your client is under financial pressure. Another indicator could be the company's share prices are not doing good in the market, and then it could be a potential risk factor that the company will do something wrong about it. So look out for those risk factors. If you find those kind of fraud risk factor, in those cases, there are higher chances company may have some kind of fraud risk. When we do our audit should be designed in a way that those potential fraud risks can be covered. If we are not covering it fully, at least we can assess the risk. If it is material, try to gather more evidences around it, and then discuss with people who are charged with governance. The people who are charged with the governance comes into the top layer, like chairman and board. Then comes the management part. Whenever you find those kind of risk indicator, please discuss those points with the people who are charged with governance as well as the management. because it's their responsibility to prevent fraud, not ours as an auditor. So in a nutshell, as an auditor, our task is to design our audit in a way so that fraud risk assessment can be done, and if there are fraud risk factors, we can extend the scope of audit and gather more evidences around it. There are a lot of chances that auditor might miss out those risk factors. As we always know that auditor use a term in their report which says, we in our opinion the company's financial statements are true and fair. That's a very commonly used word. Worldwide in audit report you will never find a word we certify. Across world the term which is being used is called in our opinion. Why auditor always give opinion? Because there is always audit risk involved. Audit risk is there are chances that there are certain things which may be missed out during audit. So auditor can only give opinion up to an extent, up to best of his knowledge, but he cannot certify. There are still chances that some error could not be traced. So here also there are chances that auditor may miss out those factors which are related to fraud or which may be potential risk factor. It's entirely auditor's skillfulness and his knowledge as to how he can capture those areas. There are certain areas where auditor need to really dig down to get more information. There are very least chances that fraud will come up on its own in a very transparent manner. So generally auditor needs to really dig down in the transaction if he's little suspicious about it, and then try to collect more evidences to prove that it is a potential risk or a potential fraud risk. So that is what auditor's fraud risk related responsibility, which is covered under ISA 240 and ISA 315. So in a nutshell, if you have to summarize this, the auditor is under not having a primary responsibility to detect fraud, but at the same time, their audit should be done in a manner that they can cover all material risk areas as well as fraud risk factor. Whenever they come across any situation which can be potential fraud, they have to gather more evidences around it and they have to discuss it with the management. There can be certain chances where the people who are charged with governance are also involved. There are certain cases worldwide, such as Satyam, such as Enron and other cases where the top layer itself was involved in fraud. In those cases, the question arises that auditor will discuss with whom? People who are charged with governance themselves are involved. In any case, auditors are abide by code of conduct, which says that you have to maintain the confidentiality of your client. Agreed. But there's nothing in the law which can bind the auditor or force the auditor to continue with the assignment. If that's the scenario where the people at top layer are also involved in the crime, in those cases, the first thing auditor needs to be done is he has to resign from this assignment. If auditor continue with the assignment and sign the report as clean report, that means auditor himself is involved in the fraud. So that's where auditor needs to resign with immediate effect, and if possible, and depending on how material this thing is, they have to take a call whether to take legal opinion or to discuss with the outside regulatory bodies, whichever is applicable to that industry. That's all about this chapter. Thank you so much.